Why do we all learn like our grandparents did? Our technology has improved. Free online courses, interactive computer applications, multimedia, and now virtual reality. But for the most part, we study the same way. Rereading, cramming, and studying for grades without even a second thought. One question has driven me for the past decade. Can we learn better? And while searching for answers to this question, I've come to believe that learning better is one of the most important ways humanity as a whole can improve. The amount of knowledge and skill a single person has to absorb in his or her lifetime seems to multiply every year. Career expertise in the fields of science, research, education, business, law, and more seems to multiply every year. Companies require new employees to take on board administrative systems, policies, and company cultures. And more importantly, we face complex global issues such as climate change that require intelligent and immediate action. We have to learn better and faster. As an engineer turned educator, I am certain we must leverage science and research to develop learning systems and study systems for ourselves. For the past 40 years, the fields of neuroscience, cognitive science, and psychology have been illuminating the inner workings of the human mind and brain. From gene expression in our neurons, to neuroplasticity, long-term potentiation, to growth mindset, grit, and cognitive biases, the body of research continues to grow. While much of this might seem inaccessible to much of the population, I would like to show you three techniques tonight to enhance your learning. Many of us reread notes, textbooks, manuals to prepare for tests and job interviews. But there is a better way than rereading. Testing more. Researchers from Washington University and Duke University found that testing just after initially learning produced better retention. In other words, holding the information in your memories. 1 week after learners memorized vocabulary, they were tested for retention. Those who had tested once or multiple times just after studying performed 20 to 40% better than those who did not test at all. Testing helps, but the research gets better. In a study conducted by the universities of California, San Diego, and of South Florida, the effects of feedback and lack of feedback were investigated. During initial learning and testing, there were two groups. One, they received no feedback on incorrect responses, and the other group that received the correct answers just after incorrect responses. In a final test 1 week later, those who had received feedback performed impressively 500% better. Now, I often tell my students, practice the way you want to play. And I ask them, encourage them, to collect and complete past tests and quizzes from their classes. And with standardized test prep, this is par for the course. Students often come in on weekends to take mock tests, and just before the big exam day, they take several tests. This kind of practice helps. So what can we all do? Well, design your studying around testing and feedback. Use flashcards, self-quiz, get those mock tests, do Q&A with your friends. Stop rereading. Start testing. But you might be thinking, testing can quickly turn into cramming. How can we move our knowledge into our long-term memories? Well, we'll have to make learning a bit more difficult with spacing and interleaving. Spacing has strong evidence across multiple research papers. Spacing, in other words, doing your review spaced out across days, weeks, months, even years. In a language learning study spanning 9 years, spacing review over longer and longer distances was seen to produce better results on tests 5 years after the learning period. The participants were put into three groups. Those who studied every 2 weeks, every 4 weeks, or every 8 weeks for 26 sessions. After that, they took a test every year for 5 years. Those who studied in the longer sessions, every 8 weeks, performed better on the final assessment 5 years after the learning period. Spacing helps. Now, we might not all have 9 years to study something, but there is a way to make learning more effortful and effective. Interleaving. In other words, mixing related study topics together. In a study conducted at the University of South Florida, researchers taught 4 geometry techniques to university students. In one group, the blockers, the students learned one technique and then practiced it, and then moved on to the second technique and then practiced it. But the other group, the interleavers or mixers, learned all 4 techniques and then practiced all 4. Now, during the practice period, these practice periods, the blockers performed 30% better than the mixers. Nice. But during a final test, a week later, the interleavers had it with 3 times the performance of the mixers. So, in my case, it might seem a little crazy, but I enjoy teaching test prep. TOEFL, TOEIC, SAT, ACT, it might seem a little crazy, but in fact, it fits perfectly within this. You've got a student who has a set test date and you plan backwards with lessons, homework, mock tests. And interleaving is perfectly suited for this. Each section is a mixed set of math questions or grammar rules. So how do I know that this actually works? Well, months later, after my students have taken the test, they come back for their college essays. And when we're editing them, they remember the grammar rules that we have studied months earlier. How can we all use this? Well, the simple principle is plan. Plan backwards from your test dates, from your assignments, and space it out. And also learn afterwards, right? Don't let it go. With interleaving, mix your topics. Not just history and biology, but 3 topics in history mixed together, or 3 topics in biology, mitosis, meiosis, and fertilization, for example. So stop cramming and start planning. But planning and simply thinking about your learning requires a particular skill, metacognition. Basically, thinking about your learning. It involves self-awareness and self-improvement of one's learning. In 2008, researchers at the University of Houston surveyed students' metacognition and compared it with GPA. They found a correlation between high levels of metacognition and high GPA. Nice, great. But can we add metacognitive activities into our own studies and classes? Yes, we can. In 2013, researchers at Louisiana State University's included metacognitive reflections into high school calculus classes. The participants studied 2 chapters, chapter 2 and chapter 3. With chapter 2, there were no metacognitive reflections, but with chapter 3, they did regular reflections. For comparison, they assessed the students' understanding of the chapter concepts both before and after. With chapter 2, the performance improvement before and after the learning period was an average of 53%. Whereas with metacognitive reflections, students increase their scores by 88%. Okay, one other thing. In previous years, students consistently reported Chapter 3 content as being more difficult than Chapter 2 content. So what was the secret? The regular reflections included questions such as, what did you struggle with in class? What would help you next time? And was your studying effective? Metacognition helps. One of my students does regular reflections after her lectures or reading the textbook, even after TED Talks. It forces her to think about what she is learning and how she is learning. In fact, these reflections have helped her move to the top of her class. So, how can we use this? Just start reflecting on your learning, your goals, your performance. Discuss with your peers. Keep a journal. Stop just studying. Start reflecting. Now, in my own reflections, I can see I've come to somewhat of an answer to my original question. Can we learn better? Yes. We live at a time when science and research is discovering more and more about how humans learn. But beneath and beyond the research, there are stories of learners. And within, there is your story. As a student, as a father, a mother, as a working member of society. But will your story remain the same? Rereading, cramming, and not thinking twice about learning? Or will this be the story of the day that changed how you think about learning? When you started testing, planning, and reflecting. Maybe today is the day that you begin to crave, like me, the science and research of how to learn better.